Good morning, everybody. Welcome to SouthNaz. Thank you for joining us online for a time of worship to our Lord. Let's sing together. Our hope is in Him and not in any situation or power we have in ourselves.
My soul sings out as your word throws doubt far away. I sing to you and my heart cries holy, hallelujah, Father, your name. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long.
Good morning, South Church of Nazarene, and happy Mother's Day. We are so excited that you are here today worshiping with us. And as we celebrate our mothers, a lot of us in distance over Zoom or over FaceTime, but we are thankful for you mothers and all that you have done for every single one of us. This morning, we have a few announcements that we want to make sure you're aware of. And first of all, we would love for you to go to our SouthNaz.org site. And while you get on there, please fill out a Connect card. We would really appreciate if you would do this for us. It helps us to know who is actually online worshiping with us and to let us know if you have any communications for us. So please go on there, fill that out for us. Also, you can go on there and fill out the bulletin. You can click the bulletin button, and as you're on the bulletin, it'll pull up information about what's going on, and or that lack of information about what's going on. And also, it'll give you an opportunity to print off Pastor Brad's sermon notes for his sermon today. So make sure that you go that. And also, you can click the online giving button so you can give online and go through that part of it to give to the church. And we are so thankful for what you have been doing in that part of our church ministry. Also, if you haven't downloaded the Remind app, we would ask that you would either download the Remind app or text 81010 to at SouthNaz. And as you do that, you're going to be added to our text group that we send out text to also communicate to our church staff. So make sure that you fill that out so we can communicate with you also on that part. Also, if you haven't downloaded our SouthNaz app, please download that. It'll do the same things that you can do on the SouthNaz.org. And it's a little bit easier just because it's right at your fingertips, and you can do that at the Google Play Store or Apple Store. So make sure that you do that. Also, next Saturday, May 16th, is our walk for 6K for World Vision. If you have not signed up, there's still time to sign up, so please sign up for that. And know this, that you don't have to do it on the 16th. You can do it any day that you and your family would like to do it, but it's a great way to support World Vision, and we would love for you to participate in that. Also coming up on the 16th, we have a drive-up shower for Taylor Delbridge and Brandon Winter, who are going to be getting married here soon. We would love for you to participate with that. It's going to be from 11 o'clock until 2 o'clock at the church, and you just drive by and kind of wave or whatever you feel most comfortable with that, so make sure you put that on your calendar for that. Also coming up, you guys are going to be receiving very soon a survey from an email from us from the church with questions about what meeting together will look like. And we would love for you to fill out that survey just to kind of help us as we start gearing up for what the next steps are going to be as we start to meet again. So please, once you get that email, fill out that survey for us. It would be great, and we appreciate that. We also have a video that we want you to watch this morning for mothers, and we just are so thankful for all that you mothers have done for us. And as we continue to worship this morning, listen to this video and then continue to worship with us.
Well, moms, here we are. We have a special moment today that we want to celebrate with you. And we have some things that we're going to share about what moms mean to us. And Pastor Gretchen is going to share a scripture with us, and then our students are going to share. So Pastor Gretchen, why don't you share with us?
Reading from Proverbs 31. She is up before dawn preparing breakfast for her family and organizing her day. First thing in the morning, she dresses for work, rolls up her sleeves, eager to get started. She senses the worth of her work and is in no hurry to call it quits for the day. She is skilled in the crafts of home and hearth, diligent in homemaking, and she is quick to assist anyone that is in need and reaches out to help the poor. When she speaks, she has something worthwhile to say, and she is always saying it kindly. She keeps an eye on everyone in her household and keeps them all busy and productive. Her children respect and bless her. Her husband joins in with words of praise. Many women have done wonderful things, but you have outclassed them all. Charm can mislead and beauty soon fades. The woman to be admired and praised is the woman who lives in the fear of God. Give her everything she deserves. We have three questions we're going to be asking our students this morning. And our first one is, what is a mom? Grayson, what is a mom?
A mom is somebody who cares about you and takes care of you and loves you.
Brooklyn.
A mom is someone that's not only a caregiver, but everyone's number one supporter.
Elliot, what is a mom?
A mom is someone who cares for you.
And Ryan?
A mom is someone who handles arguments in her household.
Natalie, what is a mom?
A mom is someone that feeds you and takes care of.
Sharon?
A mom is not only your supporter, but also your number one best friend, someone you can go to.
And our second question, Grayson, what does a mom do?
A mom feeds you and takes care of you and the frozen safe, but
Brooklyn?
A mom manages everything in the household. She always knows what's happening. She always knows where everything is, and she's everyone's number one fan.
Elliot, what does a mom do?
She gives you things that you need.
And Ryan?
A mom is someone who helps keep you motivated to accomplish your goals.
Natalie, what does a mom do?
She helps you when you get hurt.
Sharon?
A mom is someone that can walk into your room and find something that you've been looking for hours.
All right, and our last question, Grayson, what makes your mom special?
Well, she loves you and raised you and takes care of you.
Brooklyn, what makes your mom special?
My mom is constantly giving and giving, and she's so humble and selfless, and everything she does is for her family.
Elliot, what makes your mom special?
She likes spending time with me, like when we go kayaking.
Ryan, what makes your mom special?
My mom tolerates a lot, and she's very empathetic.
Natalie, what makes your mom special?
She gave birth to me.
And Sharon, what makes your mom special?
My mom is very family-oriented and loves to do anything for her family to the point where she'll drive hours and among hours just to make someone happy.
Well, moms, we are just so excited for this. We have a little note for you to just express our thanks for you guys. Here we go. Thanks, Mom. Have a great day.
Mothers, thank you for all you've done for us and continue to do for us, and especially for the ways you lead and point us to God. I know that my mom has been hugely instrumental in pointing me to Jesus and in guiding my path as a professional minister today. And I know from my mom, I learned a lot about God's compassion and his patience and his faithfulness in all situations, and especially in times when I didn't deserve it. So, Mom, thank you so much for pointing me to Jesus. Let's sing it together with hearts of gratefulness for our Father and for our mothers who pointed us to him.
A love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Life again. I give my life to find.
to God. Now we have a great children's lesson from Pastor Gretchen.
Oh, I miss them so much. Hey kids, it's Pastor Gretchen here. I've been looking at pictures and at notes that I've written back and forth with some of my friends, and I'm just really kind of feeling down today. Just missing my friend. Like my friend Amanda, she's here in Michigan, but I can't go see her with the virus, and I just miss her a lot. We call every Wednesday, but it's just not the same when you don't get to see your friends. And then my friend Sandra, she's also here in Michigan, and she and I always would go to the movies and we'd go out to eat at different places, but I can't go and see her either. And I'm just really kind of sad today. I've got even my blanket on because I don't know, just not feeling the best because I'm really missing my friends lately. Do you know how I'm feeling? Maybe you're feeling kind of like I am, just kind of meh, and just missing your friends. Like maybe you're missing the friends that are here at church that would be meeting together, that meet in your Sunday school class, or they meet here for Power Factory, or maybe you're missing your friends that are at school. It can be really hard sometimes. You feel alone and you feel really sad. You just kind of want to curl up in a blanket and just not do anything. I have so many great memories with my friends. We had so much fun together before this virus. We'd go and get coffee. We would go and sit and talk for hours. We'd go shopping. We'd watch movies and do crafts together. And now I don't get to see them anymore. I'm sorry. I'm really feeling down today and really sad. And I just kind of want to like curl up in a corner and cry. Ugh. So that's why I'm just sitting here on my mat, because I don't really want to do anything today. And I'm just not feeling that joyful. So maybe you have some of those feelings. Maybe you're missing your friends today, or you have been missing them. It may cause you to cry a lot more, or maybe you just don't want to do anything during the day. You know, sometimes when I'm feeling sad or lonely, I like to read a Bible story. Our Bible is filled with great stories of encouragement and things that can help us get through our rough days that we might be having. Now, there's a Bible story that talks about four friends that help a friend. And you can find it in the book of Mark or the book of Luke. And I'm going to be reading from the book of Mark today. And it's Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. And it says this: When Jesus returned to Capernaum several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back home. Soon the house where he was staying was so packed with visitors that there was no more room, even outside of the door. While he was preaching God's word to them, four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. They couldn't bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, so they dug a hole through the roof above his head. Then they lowered the man on his mat right down in front of Jesus. Seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, "My child, your sins are forgiven." But some of the teachers of religious law who were sitting there thought to themselves, "What is he saying? This is blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins." Jesus knew immediately what they were thinking. So he asked them, "Why do you question this in your hearts? Is it easier to say to the paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or 'Stand up, pick up your mat, and walk'? So I will prove to you that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins." Then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, "Stand up, pick up your mat, and go home." And the man jumped up, grabbed his mat, and walked out through the stunned onlookers. They were all amazed and praised God, exclaiming, "We have never seen anything like this before." This is such a great, great story, and such an encouraging story for me to read today. Now, four friends who carried their friend to be healed by Jesus, who was paralyzed, they could have given up, and they could have just gone home and just said, Well, this was a waste of time, but they found another way to go and help their friend. As I read this story, I began to wonder, do you think that the paralyzed man was laying there on his mat complaining about not being able to walk? Now, I'm sure he struggled, and it was a very lonely time for this man. You see, when you were paralyzed, you were abandoned by your family and your friends. You'd have to sit or lay on a mat just like this one, begging for help and begging for money. So he probably sat all alone all the time. He probably had heard of others who were sick or hurting who were healed by this man named Jesus. And he may have laid there and wondered, would he too be healed? Could he be healed? But what was he to do? There was no way that this man could just get up and walk to Jesus. He was paralyzed. The only thing he could do was lay there and wait, hoping that one day Jesus would walk by and maybe this would be his chance to be healed. But that day never came. It never came right away. Day after day, he would wait. And I would just begin to wonder, was his hope slowly fading away? But then four friends came by. Without a question or a doubt, they lifted him up, mat and all, and started the journey to go and see Jesus. I can just picture the joy on this man's face as he's being carried to go see Jesus. Today was going to be the day he was going to be healed of this horrible disease. No more laying on that dusty mat. No more asking for help or asking for money. He could go and maybe see his family all over again. The four men stop. There's no way that they can even get into the house, let alone carrying this friend of theirs into this house. The man laying on his mat closes his eyes and prepares for the journey back to where he would have been laying again. But wait, they're approaching the house and beginning to climb the roof. What are they doing? They lay him down on the roof and they begin digging a hole through the roof. Would this be the moment he would be healed? Lowering him down carefully, he could see the faces of his friends looking up, trusting his friends as they lower him down, trusting that they're not going to drop him, and trusting that hopefully I make it safely down here. And then, as he's lowered down, he sees the face of a different person, not a person looking at, who are you? Or what are you doing here? But a face with a smile on his face. The one that he had heard so much about, Jesus looking down at him. And then he heard the words, my child, your sins are forgiven. Stand up, pick up your mat, and go home. Sometimes when we're going through hard times or we're feeling lonely, it's easy to not feel any motivation, or we complain about what we're going through. Now, this man who was paralyzed didn't have any choice. This was what happened to him, the circumstances that had happened to him, and he had to rely on others for help and for healing. The same can be true for you and me. God has placed special people, special friends in our lives that want to encourage us and help us when we're feeling down and when we're feeling really sad. And we can make the choice to either sit there alone and cry about whatever we may be going through, or maybe we can ask for help or seek our friends to help us through some of those hard times. Now, what I'm not saying is we shouldn't be upset or miss our friends or be sad when those things happen, because it is a hard time. We are going through times where we miss seeing our friends. We miss seeing our families. But God has placed special people in our lives to help us through those times when we are feeling sad and upset. I'm going to pray with you this morning, and then I have one little piece to let you know. So, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that even in this time where we can't see our friends face to face, God, we thank you that we have different ways that we can communicate with our friends, whether it's through FaceTime or it's through writing a letter or maybe doing driving by someone's house and waving, or it's calling someone on the phone or sending an email. God, we just thank you that we don't have to sit here and cry when we miss all of our friends, but we can talk to them in different ways, Father. And God, we just thank you that you are a God of comfort and a God of peace. And even when we are feeling alone, you haven't left us. And God, we just pray that you would help us to be people that reach out to our friends, that can help us to be encouraged, God. And God, also help us to be encouragers too, not just to be the friends that want all of this help all of the time, but that we would also reach out our hands or we would reach out our ears to people and say, I want to help you too. And I want to listen to what you may be going through too, Father. God, we thank you for this story of four friends that wanted to help a friend that needed more than just the help, or needed a lot more help than what he was able to give. And we just thank you for that. Thank you for listening to our hearts and our minds, even during this time where we are learning new things and we're doing things a little bit different. We thank you for all that you do. Amen. You know, I think I learned something here today too. I could sit here during the whole Power Factory hour and just sit here and mope and be sad all day. I could do that easily because that would be an easy thing for me to do. Or I could call one of my friends that I miss and talk with them and see maybe if there's something I could do to help them feel, because I bet you they are feeling lonely right now too. Or maybe I could, you know, look through some of my old letters and write them a letter today. Or maybe I could make a craft for one of them and send that to them. You know, I really think I should do that. Instead of me sitting here curled up in my blanket, sitting on my mat, feeling sorry for myself, I'm going to reach out to my friends and tell them how much I miss them and care for them, because I'm sure they're going through the same thing I am. So, like that paralyzed man, I'm going to pick up my mat, roll up my mat, and I'm going to go and do that exact same thing.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives.
Let's continue to praise our God and His unending goodness.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend.
As we come to our prayer time, let's listen to the scripture. Listen to my prayer, O God. Pay attention to my plea, for you are my helper. Well, there's many things that we think about when we come to prayer. And I was reading in my devotions this week, and this is one of the things I came across. Prayer is never asking God to submit His awesome power to our will and plan. Prayer is an act of personal submission to the always right will of God. Well, that's a hard prayer right now when we're going through this kind of virus and all the things that are part of that, when people that we love and care for are sick, or when we're trying to figure out what's going to happen next and how are we going to provide for ourselves. And God is at work in the midst of all of these things, in spite of our desire for them to be different. God is still at work in our circumstances, and we want to continue to bring our needs and our requests to God, knowing that He is at work on our behalf. It may not be exactly the way that we would plan it or the way that we would bring it about, but God is working and He is moving in our lives in these days. There are several things I want to remind us to pray about this morning. We want to continue to pray for Rick Mason's brother who has the coronavirus. We also want to pray for what's going to be happening next. Governors and the president and people all around the country, as well as people in local environments, are trying to figure out, what are we going to do next? How are we going to begin to reopen? What's that going to look like? How are we going to have teen camp or children's camp this summer? And all those kind of things are certainly things that we need to pray for and ask God direction about. We also want to pray for those who are sick in the midst of this. And that's the whole point of all this separation and isolation, is that people would be able to get better. And we want to pray for those who are sick and suffering. And certainly those who are working on the front lines, our doctors, our nurses, people working in the nursing homes, people serving food, people at the grocery store, the guy driving the truck to get all the stuff where it needs to be so that we can have what we need. We certainly want to pray for them. And we pray for our leaders as well. Let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You that You listen to our prayers, that nothing that we say in prayer goes to a deaf God, but a God who is listening and engaged in our story. And Father, I pray that we can trust You. You will help us to trust You in the midst of the prayers that we pray that aren't answered the way we wish they would be. Will You help us to trust that You're at work even when our prayers seem to come out with different circumstances at the end? We ask that You will guide us and direct us and shape our hearts in the midst of this. Do a work in us that we need to have done as a part of all the things that are going on around us. Father, I pray for Rick Mason's brother, Larry. I pray that You will touch him and bring healing to him. Lord, we pray that You will You'll guide and direct those who are making decisions about what happens next, whether they are decisions on a national level or a state level or a local level, or even decisions that directly affect us in our own homes or in the planning that we had for this summer. We ask that You will guide and direct each and every one of us as we try to figure out what's going to happen next and how to be in the midst of all of that, and to shape that in a way that will help us and bless You and reveal You to the world around us. Father, we certainly pray for those who are sick. We pray that You will touch them and bring healing to them, and those who are suffering, and those who are grieving with so many people who have died from this virus and the things that are a part of that and the complications that are a part of that. Father, we just pray that You'll touch and encourage and strengthen them. And then, Father, we certainly pray for those who are serving us, people who are going to work every single day. And while we wish perhaps we could go to work, we pray for those who are going to work and helping provide the food and the gasoline and all the things that we need to do in order to do life even at this minimum level. We pray that You'll bless them and protect them from being sick. And Lord, we just thank You for them. And Father, we do pray for President Trump. We pray for our Governor Whitmer, that You will bless them and give them wisdom, and may they seek and listen to counsel. And Lord, we just pray that You'll bring us to a place where we can look back on this and say, wow, look at what we learned as a nation. Look what we learned as individuals. Father, we pray that You'll guide and direct us. We never thought it would be as long as it is going. But Lord, I pray You'll give us Your wisdom and help us to have that patience we need as we're waiting. Lord, we just thank You for Your love. Now, we pray that You will speak to us. We're going to look at the words that your scripture gives to us. And Father, I pray that you will guide and direct us and shape us as we allow your word to work into our hearts and to help us to be the people that you long for us to be in our lives. In the strong, strong name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
As we continue this morning our series on guardrails, we're going to be reading a couple scriptures with you this morning. The first one we're going to be reading from is Proverbs 13:20, and then we're going to jump into 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 15. And this is what it says in Proverbs. Walk with the wise and become wise, for a companion of fools suffers harm. Let's jump over to 2 Corinthians 6, 14 through 15, and it says this. Don't team up with those who are unbelievers. How can righteous be a partner with wickedness? How can light live with darkness? What harmony can there be between Christ and the devil? How can a believer be a partner with an unbeliever? Well, here we are at the time where we are usually sitting here passing plates around to give back to what Jesus has so graciously given to us. And we want to just tell you guys, thank you so much for your generosity. You guys have been so faithful, and we're just so excited that God has continued to provide for ministries here at the church. So thank you so much for that. And as we go to give this morning, obviously we're not going to be passing plates, but you can go to the app or to our website, and you can push the online button to worship with giving, and we appreciate you and all that you are doing. Jesus, thank you so much for this time, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to come together, Lord. And as we give back to you what you have so graciously given to us, and you have blessed us, we thank you and we praise you. Go with us today as we continue to worship. In your wonderful name, amen.
I'm gonna see a victory. battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory.
Good morning, moms. We are celebrating you today, and we are just so glad that you're watching with us on our internet this morning, and we're just so thrilled to celebrate you. You know, I have two questions about Mother's Day this year. First of all, where are you going to eat? I'm concerned that your husband can't take you to a restaurant. I'm hoping that he's made plans and will have food for you. And my second question is, I hope that you got some cards from your kids. You know, most of the time, those school teachers help kids make cards for their moms, and they send them home with them, and hopefully Dad took care of that as well. But we celebrate you, and you are very special to us. You know, as I think about moms, I think about one of the traits that my mom had caring for me as a kid. She was pretty serious about, pretty fanatical about who I spent time with. They even made plans for us to switch schools. My parents did. They wouldn't let us play at so-and-so's house. There were times where our family moved so we could be in another place. If they would have arranged your marriage, if we'd let them, they would have arranged our marriage. Probably thought it was all so ridiculous. But now, as parents, we have so many different tools that our parents never had. We have electronic surveillance systems. We have video doorbells. You can check your kids on Facebook. You can read their texts. Some of you do. And you can know how many minutes they use on their phone or how much screen time they have. And some have gone so far as to use the GPS system in their kids' phones to find out where they are at any given time. You know, when I was growing up, we never talked about it, but I'm pretty sure that my parents moved from one part of Kansas City to a bedroom community outside of the city just to get us away from one of the negative influences in my sister's life. And I also know a dad who in that new town we moved to, who accepted a job far away so that he could get his son away from the destructive three amigos of Danny, Donnie, and Brad. And by the way, all three of us are in the ministry together today. So why are parents so careful about who they spend time with, who their kids spend time with? We know, like your parents knew, that kids that are friends determine the direction or the quality of our children's lives. Well, last week we began a series of messages called Guardrails, How to Live Wise in a Difficult World. And again, some of those thoughts come from a book I read by a guy named Andy Stanley, who pastors in Atlanta. As we heard the Apostle Paul said last week in Ephesians chapter 5, the days are evil, make the most of every opportunity. Well, life at times can be like an adrenaline-pumping adventure. To some of us, that sounds great. We like that idea. For others, not so much. And while we can avoid the death-defying curves of a road without guardrails, life still presents plenty of danger on its own. And guardrails are the things that we place 2 or 3 feet away from the danger zone. In other words, if you were to go all the way around Lansing, Michigan, and take out all the guardrails that have been placed here in town, it would give us extra space to drive. It might even let bikes go down the road a little bit easier. Unfortunately, it would also put us close to the things that someone considered dangerous. You can almost always find guardrails within the realm of safety so that we will not enter into the area of danger. We all know that what a guardrail is. A guardrail is a system designed to keep vehicles from straying into dangerous or off-limit areas. And I often wonder, what would it look like to have guardrails in other areas of our lives? What if we had guardrails in our relationships, on our finances, in our dating, or in our morality? And what if we had a guardrail on how we do business, or the ethics that we live by, or even our reputation? What would it look like to have guardrails, and how would they help us? Well, the truth is this: our greatest regrets would probably have been avoided if we'd have had guardrails in our lives. What would it look like to have guardrails in other areas of our lives? Guardrails that are so strong and so established that when we bump up against them, it would cause us pain in our conscience. God invites us to establish guardrails so that we would be protected, He would direct us, and He could provide for us. Now, advertisements often bait us into doing things that are unwise financially. Buy this, 60 easy payments for a limited time only. And then when we do make those decisions and things don't go quite the way we were hoping, the culture chastises us for being irresponsible. Well, today I want to talk about one particular area. I want to talk about friendships and who is actually leading us, influencing us, molding us in our relationships. And here's the deal with friendships. We always want friendships. We want friends, right? And at some point in life, you're going to have people that are close to you, friends that you work with, friends that are a part of your family even, and people that you just hang out with. And you're going to find yourself in an unavoidable close proximity to people whose lives are moving in the opposite direction that you are. Maybe it's your friends, maybe it's your coworkers, maybe it's your family. And in that case, you're going to have to make some space, or they will influence you in a negative way. So we're going to need a guardrail when it comes to these relationships. All of us could tell a story about being distracted or tempted by people who have different values than us, different morals, or even a different agenda. And the reason that we are attracted to people is because we are acceptance magnets. We are repelled by rejection. Nobody wants to be rejected. We all want to be accepted, so we're attracted to being accepted. And when I'm with people that accept me, then I drop my guard. I lower my guard. Now, I know that you're not sitting right here in the audience, but think about for a moment. Imagine with me for a moment the first cigarette you ever smoked, or the first alcoholic drink that you ever had. Most of us would say we were with somebody. Now, some of you can say, I never had one, Pastor, I don't know. But there's a lot of things that we have done in our lives that that we have gotten into because of the people around us. Our greatest regrets don't often revolve around our enemies, do they? Our greatest regrets often revolve around our friends. Some of the most addictive behaviors, the most behaviors that we acquire, that we begin as a pastime, it's fun, we began with friends. The things that make up friendship are wonderful, and they are also very dangerous. We drop our guards, we experience acceptance, and acceptance leaves us open to influence. Now, maybe you're a little bit surprised what you've done, even as an adult, by the people that you've surrounded yourself with. We are swept up with this principle because it's true. And it's not just something for students. It's for all of us. At some level, our friends influence the direction and quality of our lives. Now, this isn't something we decide. This is not just something we choose. I'm going to let Bob influence me. No, it's a principle. The people that we hang out with are the people who are going to influence us, and the people we are going to be influenced by can either influence us for good or for evil. Your friends will influence the direction and quality of our lives. Did you know that 85 to 90% of the people who come into a relationship with God, they came because a friend or a family member told them about God? Seldom was it based on some amazing sermon from the pastor. Your friends will influence the direction and the quality of your life, not because you decide to let them, but it is the nature of friendship. So here's what Solomon wrote about friendship in the book of Proverbs. Travis read it to us earlier. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20. Walk with the wise and become wise, for a companion of fools suffers harm. Now, this is an important verse, a key verse in relating, helping us to understand the relationship of friends and how they affect us even right now in our lives. And the scripture contains both a promise and a warning. The promise is this: you will become wise by doing life with the wise. Did you know that wisdom is contagious? Wisdom rubs off. If you walk with them, if you do life with them, then wise people will influence us, and a life is connected to relationships, and we are influenced by the wise. And today's decisions are connected to tomorrow's outcomes. So we decide today what we chose yesterday, or based on what we experienced yesterday. So King Solomon goes on to say, a companion of fools suffers harm. He has a promise that we will be encouraged, and we'll gain wisdom by being around people like that, and that we have relationships where we're accepted. But there's also this warning. You run the risk of something bad happening to you, Solomon says, if you run with fools. And he says this phrase, it says, you will suffer harm. That means that you will spend your entire, if that means you may spend your entire life with fools and never see the world as fools see them. You may never behave as fools act, but eventually, listen, the shrapnel of the explosion of their lives, the devastation that will occur in their lives, will impact you whether you ever adopt their way of thinking or not. You may say, Pastor Brad, I have a friend who does something that's destructive. I'm never, ever going to do that destructive thing. But the reality is the shrapnel from their life exploding is going to affect you and hurt you as well. Now, this is where the deception lies. So I tell myself, I'm really not like them. I'm not as bad or as wild or as crazy as them. I'll be all right. But listen to those words again. Walk with the wise and become wise. The companion of fools suffers harm. The warning is not the companion becomes a fool, but rather it's this shrapnel that we need to worry about. Now, you've seen this. There are people who you will never walk again because of this principle. They were with the wrong people at the wrong time and consequently suffered the consequences of somebody else's choices. The second thought is this: a fool in Proverbs is someone who knows right from wrong but doesn't care. He or she lives as if it isn't connected. Today's today, tomorrow is tomorrow, I can do whatever I want. The fool isn't going to say, oh, I didn't know that, thank you. No, a fool is someone who says, I don't care. Can't you see where this is taking you? I don't care. Haven't you seen what happens to other people? I don't care. Do you think that they won't find out? It doesn't matter. When you're warned a fool, he doesn't say, "What? I had no idea. Thanks for the warning." No, a fool is someone who says, "I get that, but I don't think it's going to happen to me. I get that, but I don't really care about what's going on." The warning has to do with proximity. When you eventually go down, you will go, when they eventually go down, you may go down with them. Wrong place, wrong time. The second thought is this: friends aren't careful with their lives, or excuse me, friends who aren't careful with their lives won't be careful with yours. Friends who don't take care of themselves won't take care of you. Friends that don't take care of their marriage won't take care of yours. Friends who are irresponsible with their finances will be irresponsible with yours. Friends who don't mind abusing their bodies won't mind if you abuse yours. Friends who cheat will feel better about them if you will cheat also. Friends who break the law won't confront you about breaking the law. Friends can be dangerous, and danger requires guardrails. Now, as I'm talking, some of you have a face that has popped into your mind. You're thinking, how did he know about that guy? Or how did he know about that lady? I didn't know. Solomon did. Inspired by God, thousands and thousands of years ago, Solomon teaches us this principle. It's a principle, not a decision. This is not something you violate. This is something that you ignore. Last week when we were talking about what it means to be careful how you live, he says that he talked about this understanding, and understanding didn't mean, oh, I get all the information. Understanding literally meant I'm willing to accept the information that I've been given to me, and that's exactly what we're talking about. This is not something you ignore. You'll ultimately pay for it. So friendships are also a two-sided coin. You engage to your benefit, and consequently, you are rewarded for it. And you can engage to your detriment, and you will experience consequences for that. Now, as I'm giving you this, I know that some of you are going to say something like this. Now, Pastor Brad, you are always talking about building connections with our neighbors. You're always talking about reaching out to those who are lost. You invite us to have conversations with people who don't necessarily believe the way you believe, but the way we believe, and you're inviting us to engage in those kind of relationships. And this that you're talking about, separating from fools, that doesn't sound very compassionate. That doesn't sound very loving. It doesn't even sound Christian. It doesn't sound like what would Jesus do, or who would Jesus hang out with. And do you think Jesus had guardrails? Well, those are great questions. We're going to set those aside for a few minutes. I promise we're going to come back to them. We don't want anything to get way of the things that we're going to be talking about as far as guardrails. So here are some guardrails that I want to challenge you to consider that should light up when it dawns on you that there's something going on in this relationship. So the first one is this: when it dawns on you that your core group is moving in a different direction than you want your life to be moving, it's a good indication that you need a guardrail. In fact, Travis read the scripture before. Team up with those who are unbelievers? How? Don't do that. How can the righteous be a partner with the wicked? How can light live with darkness? What harmony can be between Christ and the devil? How can a believer be a partner with an unbeliever? This is one of the reasons that we invite you, we encourage you, we try to inspire you to join a community, a life group, a connect group, where you can learn and be challenged, and we can be a part of a relationship together. And I just want to tell you this: don't spend years coming to church sitting in rows. God has invited us to sit in circles. He wants us to have relationships with people who are moving in the right direction, moving in the same direction that we are. And our connect groups, our whole small group idea, our strategy is to help jumpstart new relationships with people who are hopefully moving in the same direction that you're moving. People that you do life with, These are the people in my small groups that I hang out with. They are people that I eat with, I play with, I learn with, I cry with. They are my spiritual family. And I don't want to just encourage you to take some proactive steps. I want you to make the most of every opportunity. Isn't that what we talked about last week? Paul says, seize the day. Make the most of every opportunity. Be intentional about finding yourself a group of people who are moving in the same direction. That's guardrail number one. Because as strong as you are, as disciplined as you are, a companion of fools eventually will suffer harm. If your closest relationships are with unbelievers, or those who are not going in the same spiritual direction, those who do not have the same moral commitment, those who are not seeking God's direction, protection and provision, then you are unequally yoked. I was speaking to a lady the other day. She was having trouble in her marriage. Her husband wasn't meeting her needs. They were drifting apart, and she began to talk with a friend who was in the midst of a divorce herself. And the people she worked with, unbelievers, who were also in bad marriages, sat around and comforted one another. And she began to go out after work with them and began to understand their circumstance. And she began to shut off all communication with other believers because they didn't understand. Their marriages were perfect, or at least that's what she thought. So what do you suppose happens to her? Her family was irreparably harmed in part because she had a relationship with people who were foolish, encouraging her to go the same direction that they had gone. Or maybe it dawns on you, you know what? I'm kind of a lone ranger. I don't have a safe group, a group of people that I can connect with. Well, that needs to concern you. That needs to bother you. The second thought is this. When you catch yourself pretending to be someone other than who you really are, when someone tells you that you act differently around him or her, then we're moving in the wrong direction. If your relationship as regular life is like this, and then when you're with that person, you do things that you wouldn't normally do, then that's a guardrail. That's something that tells you that there is danger just beyond the edge. The third thing is this, when you feel pressure to compromise. Now, that something that has never really been a temptation to you becomes a live option, something you consider, it should scare you to death. Your friends value what's valuable to you. So when you know that you are in a relationship where you're going in different directions, that's a guardrail. You need to change that. You need to work on that. When you know that you feel compromised or you're pretending to be someone else, when you've ever heard yourself say, "I'll go, but I won't participate. I'll go, but I won't participate." That's a guardrail. That's perhaps something you need to rethink. That's something that you need to think about. How am I going to invest my life in this circumstance? Now, there are always exceptions to this, and we'll even talk about those in a minute. And the fifth thing is this. You hope the people you care about won't find out where you've been or who you've been with. That should catch your conscience. When you discover, when it dawns on you that you're concerned about somebody finding out that you were hanging out with these people or you were going to this place with those people, then it's something that should probably catch your conscience. Not because you have to defend anything that you did. Maybe you didn't do those things that they were doing, but it's because something on the inside of you tenses up when you're worried about somebody finding out where you might have been. Wisdom says, if it bothers me that people I have respect for and love for who would know where I was, that's a limit. That's a red flag. That's a guardrail. Now, maybe you won't accept all five of these. I think it'd probably be a good idea if you did. I think it might be wise for you to think about that. We're going to cover those again in just a moment. But what I want you to do is listen. The goal is not for you to do these five things. My goal for you is to recognize the danger and the pitfalls that are sometimes connected to relationships so that you can establish guardrails that will keep you safely back from the oncoming traffic. Because our world is a place that's dangerous, and sometimes it's unavoidable if we find ourselves in that place. So back to the question that you asked a moment ago about being compassionate, loving, and helping those who aren't like you spiritually. Well, we aren't supposed to have friends. Aren't we supposed to have friends who are different from us? And the answer to that is absolutely. And if you've heard much about Jesus, you know the Bible uses this phrase for him. He was a friend of sinners. You may say, I love this person, I love these people, I care about them, and we absolutely need to. But here is God's word for you. You can read this in the New Testament because Jesus modeled it over and over again. And listen, if you don't hear anything else I say today, hear these words. The best that you can do for a person you love, the best thing you can do for friends that you have compassion for is to stay on the side of the guardrail so that when they crash, you're healthy enough to actually help them. You're the go-to person because you're healthy. Don't confuse guardrails with a lack of concern or love. One day, those same people are going to need you to be in a position to help. Not creating margin in a relationship is dangerous. Developing connections, deep connections with people who are going in the same direction and face up or understand what God's will for you is. Now, when I was talking, did someone come to your mind? Maybe it's more than one. If you could push a button and immediately be disengaged with no complications, would you push that button? So if you were the Heavenly Father, what would you say? Or maybe on Mother's Day, if you were God speaking to us as a caring, loving mother, what would you say? How close would you get? Would you say things like, I'm going to be careful. I'm going to drink responsibly. Or this is another one I heard this week. Know when to quit before you start. Isn't that catchy? But how helpful is it? It's true, yes, it's great, yes, but it's like get as close as you can, but know when to quit before you stop. No, that's not how to handle that. It's knowing how far to stay away before you ever think about it is a better way to look at that. So what is your Heavenly Father calling you to? Here's my question. Will you consider the friendship guardrails or maybe set some of your own? Here are these guardrails again. Your closest friends not going in the same direction, that's a guardrail for you. That should light up some lights for you. Pretending you're someone you're not when you're with them. Feeling the pressure to compromise. You say, I'm going to go, but I won't participate. Or we say, I hope and pray that so-and-so won't find out. Positive step, build relationships with spiritually wise people. Maybe in a small group of men or a group of couples or a Sunday school class or something like that. Build a positive group of friends, of wise people who can help you in your spiritual journey. A year from now, you may wish you had. So, why not pretend that today is the day of your second chance and to move back behind the guardrail? Be intentional about walking with the wise, because eventually a companion of fool will suffer harm. Pretty powerful words today. You know, Solomon can get us to think about things that just seem so simple and yet are so profound. I want to encourage us to set a guardrail in our lives about the people who are building influence into us, who are pushing us in a certain direction. If you are wanting to line your heart up with the heart of God, then you need to line your relationships up with people who have a heart for God as well. Certainly love and care and invite, but be healthy enough to have something to offer when our friends who are not going in the same direction we are suffering. We need to have something to offer to them that says, I can help you get out, not I'm going to help stand in the puddle with you. I can help you get out. I pray that that will be God's plan for us as a congregation. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. You teach us some hard truths, that we are not to be so bound to people who believe and think differently than us, that they have the influence and can push us one direction or another. In fact, your word says, what commonness is there in light and darkness? They just don't match. So, Father, I pray that you will help us to build relationships with people who are moving in the right direction, moving in the same direction we are. Help us to set up guardrails so that we can make wise choices in our relationships. And Father, I know that there are folks in this, watching this broadcast today, that maybe some of those negative influences in their lives are part of their family. Maybe it's an unbelieving spouse. Maybe it's a parent or a brother or a sister or some other family. Maybe it's people they work with. Father, I pray that you will give them wisdom to know when they are being influenced in a way that is destructive. Give them courage to follow you in obedience regardless of what people around them are doing, and give them the compassion to reach out and help those who are in trouble. Lord, will you help us to be healthy enough to offer a hand? We ask for your direction in what we're doing, Father. We can't break some of those relationships. That would be inappropriate. Lord, I pray that you will help us to build around us people who are nudging us in the right direction so that you may be glorified in our lives as we seek to serve you in this difficult world. Lord, there is a world of challenge around us. Danger is everywhere. But Lord, we don't have to live controlled by fear. We want to be controlled by your Spirit, empowered by godly relationships so that we can be the people you've made us to be. Help us to do that. In Jesus' strong name I pray. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you next week.